Hi, I'm Stephen Ash, a practicing physician with Indiana University Health, Arnett, in Lafayette, Indiana. Today is June the 20th of 2014, and I have the pleasure today to interview Dr. Marty Roberts, a long-term friend and associate with many common interests. Marty has been responsible for a number of innovations in the dialysis field, including creating the first commercial and practical PD solutions, working with Dr. Maxwell at the time, inventing the first workable and repeatable PD catheter, the Trocath, design of a number of IV solutions, working with Don Baxter Company, developing the vinyl tubing sets, blood tubing sets, now used for hemodialysis, and then, of course, the sorbent kidney, the sorb regenerating column. It's still the only practical method for reusing and treating dialysate to remove toxins. Marty received a Bachelor of Science in Chemistry, College of New York, in 1942. Went to Brooklyn College, got a Master's in Organic Chemistry, working on pyrimidine synthesis, and finally a PhD in Biochemistry at the University of Southern California. We are deeply thankful to Marty for his long support to ASAIO, and he's been a stalwart member and contributor. So, Marty, I had a few questions. What led you to get a master's degree in organic chemistry and then a PhD in biochem?
Well, I had a bachelor's degree in chemistry, and I was working for a beer consulting firm, and my job was assaying the beer, and it seemed to me that I didn't want to be assaying beer for the rest of my life. So I decided that I would take a master's at night while I was still working. So the unusual thing is that Brooklyn College allowed you to take a master's at night. It took me 3 years to get a master's. Mm-hmm. And once I had a master's, I realized that that I didn't know as much as I thought I knew. I needed a doctorate. So I went on, I applied for a scholarship and received a teaching scholarship from the University of Southern California, and that's how I ended up at USC and in Los Angeles.
And moving from New York to California was a side benefit, right?
That is correct. I like swimming in the ocean, and I said, well, I can now swim in the Pacific Ocean.
Yeah, might as well. You first became familiar with dialysis, related to the subject of peritoneal dialysis.
Yes, with food, what Maxwell wanting me to make a first commercial PD solution. Mm-hmm.
And up to that time, how was Dr. Maxwell doing PD?
He was making his own catheters, he was making his own solution in the laboratory.
It was a lactate-based solution as well?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. What were his catheters like?
His catheter was a nylon catheter, and he inserted the nylon catheter using a large trocar. Mm-hmm. So the method was to insert the trocar, remove the obturator, and insert the catheter, pull the tubing out, and then sew the catheter into place in the peritoneum.
Mm-hmm. And in your invention, the Trocath was a single insertion with a pointed stylet inside a relatively stiff catheter, right?
I use the Maxwell catheter, which is a stiff catheter, mm-hmm. and instead of using a separate trocar, I made the trocath into essentially a trocar with the catheter being the outside tubing, mm-hmm. and with the wire being the obturator. Mm-hmm. And the advantage there was that the hole made by the obturator was smaller than the catheter, so the catheter stretched the skin and it was automatically sealed. There was no need to do any stitching.
And you tested this in animals, I guess?
I tested this in rabbits.
Mm-hmm. To make sure that the shape was such that it would go through the peritoneum but not through the bowel.
No. Not quite, no. Well, the thing that I was interested in, all Trocars were three-pointed. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to know whether there was a real reason for the 3 points or whether that was just circumstance. Mm-hmm. So I inserted, I made the obturators with a single point, I made it with 2 points, I made it with 3 points, I made it with 4 points, and I pushed it through the skin of a rabbit, and I also pushed it through some stakes or the other test method to see whether there was a difference in the point, and it turned out that the 3-pointed Trocar was the right way to go.
I've stayed ever since.
Yes.
Then you also designed some IV solutions with Kendall McGaugh for particular, or more with Don Baxter Company. Is that right?
Yes. My first solution was, interesting enough, the first job I had at Don Baxter was to make a solution, oral solution, as a nutritional solution, and it was called Glorigen. It was a concentrated solution of starch and sugar, and it was given by a nasal tube. The nasal tube was designed by someone else, and the solution was run directly into the patient's stomach by means of the nasal tube. That was the first solution I made. After that, I started talking to physicians and found out that there was a need for solutions for acidosis, for alkalosis, for unique situations, and started making unique solutions for that purpose.
And in terms of creating the commercial PD solution, what were the challenges you had, and what made it a successful PD product?
Well, there were essentially two challenges. First of all, you wanted your solution to be clear and colorless. Mm-hmm. And some solutions precipitated when you sterilize them. Mm-hmm. Some solutions turn brown when you sterilize them. Mm-hmm. So the job was to correct the formulation so that they were clear and colorless.
You adjusted the pH? You came up with the pH range?
pH was one way. Changing the ingredients was another way, of course. Mm-hmm. And then the other part of the problem was that the solution should not precipitate or change color in storage for a year. Well, it takes a year to do that, so one of the ways is to heat the solution up to 60 degrees centigrade and keep it at 60 degrees centigrade for a period of time and see whether it turns yellow or precipitates under those conditions. And that's how you would be an accelerated storage test.
Speaking of PD solutions, when I started doing peritoneal dialysis in the mid-70s, all the solutions came in glass bottles.
That's correct. And Morton Maxwell had designed it with 2 liters, but when we started making the solution, we had to make it 1-liter bottles because the regulations required that no solution could be greater than 1 liter. So I went to the regulatory agents and told them that this should be really 2 liters and there was no danger in running 2 liters into the peritoneal cavity rapidly, and they accepted the suggestion and we were able to do 2-liter bottles.
Was it a big change for the industry going to the bags?
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Don Baxter spent a long time trying to develop bags, and eventually Baxter Laboratories was the first people to come out with a bag.
How did you come to be involved with the Seattle Artificial Kidney Supply Company, and which was a division of Sweden Freezer and in Seattle, and what did you do there?
That's a very good question, because I was at Don Baxter, and one day while I was working there, I got a phone call from Mr. Swenson, who is the CEO of Sweden Freezer. And he said to me, I would like you to come to head a dialysis division that I'm going to form called the Seattle Artificial Kidney Supply Company. I'd like you to be head of that company, and I'll pay you. Let me know how much you are making right now. I told him how much I was making right now, and the offer was so good I couldn't refuse it.
That's great.
He then invited me to, me and my wife, to come to Seattle. He put us in the best hotel in town. He had the rabbi call us and invite us to join the synagogue there. And he really put on a show, and obviously both my wife and I moved to Seattle.
Wow. And the principal physicians behind that company, I imagine, were Dr. Blagg, Dr. Scribner, and others from Seattle?
Yes. I'm trying to remember the name of the engineer. There's the engineer too, and Quentin.
Yeah, Quentin.
Quentin was involved.
Right.
So actually, Scribner and Blagg were the people who were telling me and Sweden Freezer, I should say, the Seattle Artificial Kidney Supply Company, how to build the machines and what they needed.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things they needed was a blood tubing set that was that would be commercially available. And the Sweden Freezer had a Japanese division in Tokyo, and they contacted the Japan Medical Supply and arranged for me to visit the Japan Medical Supply and show them how to make blood tubing sets.
And they were made out of PVC, vinyl,
right? PVC, yes.
Yeah.
Which at that time, all IV solutions, administration sets made out of PVC. So it was just changing from a IV solution to a blood tubing set.
Right. And that was 1966, so.
That was 1966,
yeah,
yes.
So chronic in-center dialysis wasn't around. Of course, the Northwest Kidney Center was training patients for home dialysis around that time.
That's correct.
And of course, it was used in acute. And the Seattle Artificial Kidney Supply Company made a dialysis machine at that point.
That's correct. They made a dialysis machine based upon the design by Dr. Scribner.
Mm-hmm. And what eventually happened to that company and to the product?
Well, the product, they also made a central system, and the central system was sold to many people. I stayed with the company for approximately 5 years, at which time I got an offer to get into sorbent chemistry, which sounded very interesting. And also what was interesting about it was that it was in Los Angeles, so it was an opportunity to get back to Los Angeles. So I left the company after working for them 5 years, and the company, Sweden Freezer itself, ended up going out of business because Dr. Swanson, the CEO, had no one to succeed him. So the company just disappeared.
Yeah. They made a lot of good ice cream at the time, didn't they?
No, I still have the ice cream machine. I have a self ice cream machine that I use whenever I have a party.
It still works?
It still works.
Wow.
I had to replace the Freon, but it still works.
Yeah. The story of sorbent dialysis is interesting. So Organon Technica was the one that hired you in 71.
No.
Was that right?
No, that's incorrect.
Yeah. The first one was...
there's a series of companies involved, and actually that's been one of the problems with solvent technology, is that there were too many companies involved.
Mm-hmm.
The Marquardt is a aerospace company located in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And they realized after the World War II that they were going to lose a lot of government money. So they essentially told their engineers that go out there and see what else you can do as an engineering job. So one of the engineers got a grant from the government to reclaim agricultural wastewater. The agricultural wastewater essentially has too much sodium, and if you can just remove the sodium and put it back on the soil, you could use it over again. So here's a situation where regeneration gets into the picture. And he developed a number of ion exchange resins, and the important thing is that agricultural water is very cheap, so you have to regenerate it very cheaply. And he was successful in doing this, and one of his cousins ended up on dialysis. And he said, well, why throw all that dialysate down the drain? Why don't we regenerate that dialysate? So Marquardt got a grant from the NIH, and through Maxwell and through Arthur Gordon, who actually were the persons who got the grant, because the company itself could not get a grant. And Maxwell and Gordon were both nephrologists. So they headed the group, and they hired a chemist by the name of Larry Marantz. And it was Larry Marantz who developed this sorbent system. And that was started in 1968. And that was started under Marquardt. Then they, in 1971, they decided that they're going to go on the market. And they changed the name from Marquardt to CCI Life Systems, because at that time CCI had bought Marquardt. And they wanted to have a name that would be recognized more in the field of healthcare rather than associated with aerospace. And that's the reason for the name to CCI Life Systems. So I was hired by CCI Life Systems, and I was the first person to join the company who is knowledgeable in the dialysis field. Everyone else was in the aerospace field, or had been hired just for the job of developing the sorbent system. So my job to begin with was to convert a research machine to a machine that could be manufactured and sold. So we went to a rather complex machine to a very simple machine, and at that time most patients were home patients. So the machine was designed for use by a patient at home. They had only three knobs, and one knob was the major knob, so it was very easy for a person to learn how to use the machine.
And for many years, that machine remained pretty much unchanged, right?
That is correct. Well, to begin with, since CCI had no market in the medical field, my first job was to try to find people who could market the machine. And I went to see Baxter, I went to see other companies. Interestingly enough, 3M was one of the companies that was interested. And they all decided that the sorbent system wasn't going to sell. So I ended up setting up a marketing group to market the machine myself. So I started out as vice president of marketing.
Wow, you did well at that. So what were your concerns, and what kind of tests did you have to do before you felt that this column could actually regenerate dialysate?
Well, by the time I came there, they had already done dog work and demonstrated that they could they could maintain a dog who had been nephrectomized. They had already gone to humans, so by the time I was hired, it had already been proven that the machine could maintain patients. So that was not part of my job.
When was the first time you saw a patient on a sorbent dialysis?
I think it was probably in Seattle. I remember seeing a home patient going to their home in Seattle.
What did you think
about? I thought at that time, and this is great that we can keep a patient who would have been dead within a month, that we could keep him alive indefinitely.
And that there were no obvious differences in the clinical outcome with proportion dialysate, which goes down the drain, or the sorbent, right?
That is correct.
Yeah. Don't you think it's kind of remarkable that such a simple collection of mostly inorganic things, zirconium oxide, zirconium phosphate, charcoal, and a layer of urease, can remove all of the toxins that the kidney would normally remove and not remove too much good stuff?
I can't make that claim, really.
Maybe overstated.
To this day, we're talking about 1971, 1973 when we went on the market. Mm-hmm. Even today, we don't know all the toxic materials that have to be removed. All I can say here is that we put people on this machine. They were maintained. They did well. And years went by and they still did well. And there was no evidence that we were missing something. And there was also no evidence that we were taking out the good stuff. And I would say that we did remarkably well with a system that was unique at that time.
Yeah. Yeah. As Dr. Wampler might have said, serene stupidity is a wonderful thing. So you obviously then turned your attention and desires towards regenerating peritoneal dialysate with sorbents, right?
Well, before that, I would like to add another contribution. And that is, once in 1973, with the start of private dialysis units. Mm-hmm. So many dialysis units were set up, and the market for home hemodialysis disappeared. Mm-hmm. And the ready machine had been designed for home hemodialysis. So as vice president of marketing, it was my job to find a new market. And the market that appeared to be a good niche to get into was acute hemodialysis. And the acute hemodialysis required the situation of being able to change the dialysate for the patient rather than force the patient to be maintained on a standard solution, which was the game plan at that time. Everybody was dialyzed on the same dialysate. And the big advantage of the ready system was it used only 6 liters of solution. Mm-hmm. So it would be very easy to make a special solution for a patient. And also, as you dialyze the patient, you can change the solution right in the machine. So what I did at that time was to work with a nephrologist and design special dialysates for different patients. We designed dialysates for people who had alkalosis. We designed solutions for people who had acidosis. We designed solutions for people who had low calcium, people who had high calcium, people who had low calcium. And that was the unique thing about the ready system. It was very easy to change these solutions. You could also do a stat test on the patient. And for example, if you were correcting alkalosis, and you then did a gas on them and found out that you weren't correcting it, you could then change the dialysate while the machine was running and continue to correct the patient.
So what many of us read as the sorbent primer, I take it, was one of your principal works.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, it was remarkably flexible. And you stayed with that the company as it eventually changed to Organon Technica. Right.
Organon Technica was one of our distributors in Europe. Mm-hmm. And they had signed the contract that they would sell as many machines in the year, in the following year, that we sold in the previous year. And they didn't realize that I was selling a lot of machines. So they ended up with a lot of machines, and they tried to change the contract, and they were unsuccessful. And at the same time, the guinea, which was the Dutch money at that time, had gone up and the dollar had gone down. So the easiest way was buy the company and change the contract. So Organon technically bought the company.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And Somewhere along there, you actually worked with physicians to see if you could regenerate peritoneal dialysis, right?
Yes. I started off, that was also a contract between Morton Maxwell and Arthur Gordon, and the physician who actually did the work was Dr. Blumenkrantz. Mm-hmm. And this was done at the VA hospital in Los Angeles called the Wadsworth Hospital.
Mm-hmm. And there'd been some animal tests before that, and they looked
appropriate. They'd done some dog tests.
Right, yes.
And they had shown that in the dog that the ready cartridge could be used for PD solution.
Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. The results were generally positive. There were a few problems in the patients.
There were a few problems when we began using the ready cartridge as is. We found that after about 4 hours, the patient complained of the fullness of the stomach. They just didn't feel well. And I surmised that the problem was probably due to the urease. Mm-hmm. And so I requested I went out and found somebody who could make non-pyrogenic urease. Mm-hmm. And we took out the urease from the cartridge, put the non-pyrogenic urease into a separate vial so that when the solution came out of the patient, it washed the urease into the cartridge where it was trapped by the alumina. Mm-hmm. And once we had purified the urease, we had no longer any problems with the ready cartridge. We had no reaction whatsoever. I did 20 patients. I did one patient for 2 months, and there were no reactions whatsoever from the patient.
Then there wasn't ever a commercial product which regenerated peritoneal dialysis. Mm-hmm. But somewhere along the way, you decided to make sure there was one and helped in formation of AWAC.
There's a little bit of a story there. Mm-hmm. In that Dr. Blumenkrantz and I had shown that the ready cartridge could be used for PD, we designed a machine called the, I forget the name right, Pericycle, called the Pericycle. We designed a machine Pericycle, and we gave it out to various different nephrologists for them to try and to do PD with the Pericycle. At that time, we were purchased by Organon Technica, and at the same time, that was the same year that CAPD came out. And Organon Technica decided that CAPD and everybody else mistakenly thought that CAPD would take over the entire peritoneal market, and there was no point in having a machine for PD, and they withdrew all the machines and actually destroyed them.
How many were built?
About four of them.
Wow. So there, after a hiatus of about 10 years, you did decide that the time was ripe to create a company and to create a product to regenerate PD.
No, that's not quite right.
It was just a guess.
And while I was with CCI Life Systems in 1977, I published two papers. One paper was how to build a wearable. I should really go back. I want to go back a little bit. As with the ready system, I went out and went into dialysis units, and I could see these patients sitting there spending 4 hours to 5 hours a day, 3 days a week, just sitting in these chairs, and I felt that there must be a better way of doing this. So in 1977, I published two papers, one saying that you could build a wearable doing by hemodialysis, and the second one building a wearable by peritoneal dialysis. And the company told me as this was blue sky, it would be millions of dollars to develop such a system, and there's no guarantee that it would work, and forget it. So when I retired in 1985, I called up Dr. Lee and I said, let's work on a wearable. And that's where we started working on a wearable.
Mm-hmm. And you continued to work with Dr. Lee on that for 10 years?
We worked from 1985 to 1997 when we developed a patentable idea. The idea was converted into a patent by UCLA, and the UCLA looked for a licensee to build the machine, and eventually it was Dr. Lee actually who found the licensee by going to Singapore, talking to some of his nephrologists there, and one of them said, I can line up a whole bunch of rich people and they will provide the funding for a company. So a company was formed in April of 2007 for the main purpose of building a wearable artificial kidney.
And the Singapore government contributed to that also?
The Singapore company provided some grant money to assist in that.
Okay. And I've seen prototype of the device, I believe, at our meeting. And I've seen you heard you talk about it, but can you describe how it's going?
Well, yes. So we've now gotten to a point where we feel that we can standardize the product. The product weighs 1 kilogram. It is small enough to fit into a purse or a carrier case, so that the patient will be carrying the AWAC over their shoulder. There'll be just a tube from the AWAC to the peritoneal cavity, which could be relatively hidden. And one of the things, we did a survey with patients, and they said they did not want it to be obvious that they were dialysis patients. Mm-hmm. And this is a system where it isn't obvious that the patients are dialysis. And so whatever the patient is doing, they can just leave the shoulder bag, they can put it on a table next to them if they don't want to be carrying it, if they're working. And at night, they put it on the bedstand and go to sleep. It's a 24-hour system.
Mm-hmm. This gave you an opportunity to sort of redesign sorbent call, which really hasn't changed a lot since the early days of Oregon on Technica, right?
As you alluded to earlier, when we had no problems running PD in the patients with Dr. Blumenkranz. But then it occurred to me that when we start working with, possibly working with CAPD patients and put them on the PD sorbent system, there might be a difference between, and so I ran some CAPD spent fluid through the sorbent cartridge and discovered that the protein in the CAPD solution could displace the urease off the alumna. Mm-hmm. So when we decided to make it the AWAC, we decided that we would chemically bind the urease. Mm-hmm. So that's a major change. Mm-hmm. We still have the ZP, we still have the HCO, we still have the carbon. Mm-hmm.
But are they in layers as in the other product, or is it?
That's confidential.
Confidential, okay. Off the record, it'll be more confidential probably. So.
Yes.
you've been a staunch supporter and great contributor at ASIO over the years. And at ASIO, we're always talking about what are the problems, what are the solutions, what's new, what new technologies are there. Have you felt that dialysis has really progressed in the last 20 years, for example?
No. It's interesting that you bring up the last 20 years, because the ASIO was primarily kidneys when I first joined it. I joined the ASIO in 1960. So I've been with ASIO for a long time. And over the years, it has gone into heart, and renal has become a very small part of the number of papers that are being presented, and that's because there's been very little advance. The major advances in the field has been to modernize the sensors, to modernize the machine, but as far as the patient is concerned, there's been no change. The patient still has to sit 4 to 5 hours, 3 times a week.
Mm-hmm. I guess one changes in the implementation. What do you think of the daily dialysis routine or nighttime hemo as a therapy?
I think the way to go is nighttime. There's no question in my mind that frequent dialysis is the way to go.
Mm-hmm. Biggest limitations to that?
To that is that we're now moving into a situation where it becomes too expensive to be doing frequent dialysis in a dialysis unit, so the patient has to move home. Mm-hmm. And the machines that have been developed over the years have become more and more complex and less and less capable for a patient to be using at home. So there's a need for a complete redesign of the home hemodialysis machine so that it's for a patient at home.
Mm-hmm. There have been some efforts to create machines that are somewhat easier to use at home. One of them was the Renal Solutions Alliant machine that had sorbent regeneration. Another was
The Alliant machine was not really simple. I saw the machine, and my opinion was that the Alliant machine would never sell.
Mm-hmm. It's still not on the market, by the way, mm-hmm. but a replacement is supposedly on the way. And then there was a machine from Chicago, and I've forgotten the name.
Access machine.
Access machine, yeah. What do you think? What'd you
think
of that
one? The Access machine was very good. Important feature of the Access machine is that you did not have to change the blood tubing set. You could use it over and over and over again for about 30 times. The problem with the Access machine is that after a few years of heat sterilization, the sensors went off, and they had all kinds of bugs, and they were all different, so it was difficult to correct the problem. The Access machine eventually went off the market, but the people who used the Access machine were very, very pleased with it.
Mm-hmm. And then there's been some efforts to create an implantable artificial kidney using silicon membranes and other approaches. What do you think of that?
The implantables are more than 10 years away. I do not expect to see an implantable for less than 10 years.
You would envision a machine that could be used, say, at night on a bedstand or used during the day. Would it be both? Would it be 24 hours a day with the machine envisioned?
The reason why I built the wearable, or I should say invented the wearable, is that I feel that one should be dialyzed like your ordinary kidney. You should be dialyzed all the time. You shouldn't be being dialyzed just a few hours. But I also recognize that there may be some people would prefer not to even carry a shoulder bag. So I think that the other approach will be a system that will work overnight. Short dialysis each day is a way to go, but I think that the patient will get tired. Mm-hmm. Doing short dialysis every day.
Mm-hmm. So do you envision an overnight dialysis?
Nocturnal dialysis as being the way to go. Mm-hmm. Right now, it tends to be 5 days a week or 6 days a week. It may turn out to be adequate to do every other day. Mm-hmm. And it may be an adequate way of doing nocturnal dialysis.
With peritoneal dialysis?
It makes no difference, either hemo or peritoneal.
Okay. What do you think are the biggest innovations in dialysis that you've seen? I mean, you were involved in the very early phase of both peritoneal and hemo. So what are the biggest innovations since 66?
Well, as far as the patient is concerned, very little. The big innovations I see, and is from the point of view of the, just like I was able to change the ready system to different dialysates, is now possible to change the dialysate in the single pass machines. Mm-hmm. sensors are a lot more efficient. We now have screens to tell the patient or the nurse what to do, instead of having to have a book at your side and use it. So there's less chance of errors being made. I think the major improvements have been in the machine and the use of the machine.
Mm-hmm. And do you think, how about the membrane changes? Obviously, we've gone from, you know, flat plate to coil to the hollow fiber dialysis.
Well, I started with the keel dialysis. Mm-hmm. That was quite a mess to put together. Mm-hmm. And of course, the plate dialyzer was a little bit of an improvement over that. Mm-hmm. But the plate dialyzers are big, and I think the hollow fiber is an important invention. Mm-hmm. To have hollow fiber, and as we can see, it's lasted 3 years, mm-hmm. at least last 20 years, as you brought up.
Right, and of course, controlled filtration has improved.
The control of the UF, yes.
Yeah, right.
Has improved.
Mm-hmm. Do you see a great role in ASIO in bringing about these improvements in dialysis therapy and fostering novel ideas?
Yes, the reason why I've loved the society all these years is that I feel that the society does an important thing in the field. I get up, give a paper, and somebody says, why do you think of that? Why do you think of that? And I don't agree with this, or I agree with this, so I have an opportunity to get a critique of my paper, which I don't get when I publish a paper. So I think it's important to be able to present a paper. I think it's also important. I go over to Dr. Nolf and say, I'm thinking of this, what do you think of this? Mm-hmm. Which you can't do when you read their papers.
No.
So I think there's an important use of the ASIO relative to coming there and meeting people and getting critique of what you're presenting. Mm-hmm. I'll be presenting my paper tomorrow on the AWAC, and I'm looking forward for people to tell me why I should go a different way.
Mm-hmm. Ironically, by the way, I think that the first abstract submitted on CAPD in 1976 was actually turned down by ASIO.
Yes, I understand that.
But it doesn't mean that it wouldn't have worked out, that there wasn't the same discussion going on either way. Mm-hmm. You've published over 50 peer-reviewed publications in your career, with a lot of influential and creative people. How about the publication process itself? I mean, you could invent things without doing these publications. You could test them. What's the value in publication?
The value of publication is to present to the scientific community what you've done, how you've done it, so that they can build on what you've done and improve on it. If we all kept secrets to ourselves, then there would be no progress. Mm-hmm. I think it's important to publish what you've done so that other people can improve on it, and you in turn improve on them. Mm-hmm. So you step up and move ahead. And this is one of the reasons why a patent is published, so that everybody else can see the patent, but at the same time give the inventor protection over 20 years so they can recoup the amount of money they've spent putting into developing the product.
And you also have a number of patents, I think 12 or something like that.
Yes.
U.S. patents. How about corporations? Do you see that the companies in the dialysis field are trying to innovate, to change and improve in general, or are those type of innovations only left to small companies?
Well, I think the large companies aren't doing enough in the way of speaking to patients and developing, and speaking to nurses and physicians, developing products that they want. And I think that's where the small company comes in, because usually a small company is developed by people who've been, have seen a need by either being a physician or a nurse, or working with these people, and they come out with that need, and then it usually ends up that these large corporations then eat up these small companies, and in that way they advance and begin to meet the needs of the patient. But I don't think that the large corporations are looking enough at what the needs are of the people. Mm-hmm. And this is where I think the SIO can do a job perhaps a little better than right now, if they could let, perhaps by actually publishing, unmet needs for example, I think the SIO could get experts in from various fields and say, what unmet needs are there, and actually publish these unmet needs, and let these young investigators who are looking for something to work on, look at these unmet needs and say, this is what I'm interested in, and have them work on it. That's my suggestion for SIO.
Yeah, that's very creative. Someone said that if you want to know what advancements will occur in the future, all you have to do is look at the unmet needs of today.
That's correct.
Because someone will fix it sooner or later. So speaking of that, so what do you think dialysis is going to look like in 20 years?
Well, in 20 years, I think my wearable will be out there, and a number of people will be using my wearable. I expect dialysis to move more towards the home, because I think that's the only way you can do frequent dialysis, is to do it at home. So I definitely expect the dialysis population to increase in the home. The dialysis units will be primarily for those people who are incapable of doing home hemodialysis.
So do you think with the right machine, the majority of patients could do dialysis at home?
Yes. There is, of course, with hemodialysis, there's the problem of access. There's been a large number of papers on access, and there's still a need for a better access for a home patient.
Yeah.
With peritoneal dialysis, we have the problem of the peritoneal membrane becoming too porous, so that there's a problem with fluid loss, and therefore these patients end up on hemodialysis. Mm-hmm. Now, with my AWAC, pardon me for putting in a bit for it, the AWAC is set up to deliver dialysate at a physiological pH. Whereas dialysates, which are on the market right now, are acidic. However, there are bicarbonate dialysates on the market, and so far they have not demonstrated an advantage as far as the peritoneal membrane is concerned. So I see a definite advance in the getting a peritoneal dialysate which is more biocompatible than the solutions that are on the market now.
Speaking of that, if you look at advanced peritoneal dialysis solutions, bicarb-based or pH-balanced or low glucose degradation products, most of those solutions, or all of those more physiologic solutions, are in Europe, not the U.S. U.S., we have basically glucose solutions with lactate, and we have lycodextrin. What do you think is the problem there? Do you think it's a problem in regulatory approval?
No, I don't believe the problem is regulatory at all. My personal opinion is that these companies do not see, so far, these solutions have not been shown to be that much advantageous that the American physician would be willing to purchase these solutions, and the launch companies have decided that there's no market in the United States for these solutions. That's my opinion.
Interesting, yeah.
But I'm not associated with a company, so it's definitely my opinion.
Okay. Is there any role for oral sorbent therapy?
There's been a number of people like Eli Freeman who's been in that area. I think you can perhaps use oral therapy for a short period of time to delay the start of dialysis, but I don't see oral therapy as a means of replacing dialysis.
Right.
I've been interested in diarrhea therapy, which is one oral type of oral therapy. Mm-hmm. I've been interested in the various bacteriological methods, but I don't see any of them getting to a point where they would be used.
So there's probably some toxins that could be removed pretty easily orally, say potassium or
things
like that.
Oh, potassium is a good example, yes.
Yeah. Or excess hydrogen and acidosis, but not all of the organics could be expected to be transferred.
Well, the big one is urea. Mm-hmm. I still remember Dr. Kolf coming on the stage and saying, "You mean urea is not toxic?" And he took a jar of urea and spilt it on the floor. And he says, "This is not toxic."
There must be.
This was at a SIAM meeting too.
Right. Well.
Do you remember that?
I do, actually. And my feeling is it's not the urea that's toxic, but all that nitrogen that's sitting on the floor. That's toxic. That leads to other, lots of other toxins.
Well, it's true that the urea is not toxic in small quantities, but you can't just keep on accumulating urea and urea.
Right. Or nitrogen, either one.
Right.
So what kind of recommendations would you give to a young scientist, maybe a biochemist, who's interested in improving artificial organ therapy, or artificial kidney in particular?
Well, I would say look at the patient. Talk to the nurse, talk to the physician, and see what you can contribute to the field, and you'll surely find something you can contribute.
And your career has been one really of collaboration. I mean, you've collaborated with the physicians who have great interest and great experience in new therapies, and then you collaborate with the business people. The other scientists you mentioned have been involved in the creation of the sorbent system.
I've collaborated to a point with physicians where I've actually been invited to go on Grand Rounds.
Good for you, and I'm sure you contributed as well when the questions come up. How vital is that? I mean, there may be some young scientists who figure they can do it all on their own.
All along, I've been the interface between the company and the medical profession. And I think this is an important role. The engineers design a product, and they write the directions, undo the product. I go to the physician with the directions and the product, and the first thing they do is tear open the package, put the product on the patient, and never read the instructions. Object lesson there is you design the product so that it could be used without having to read the instructions.
And is it easier in a small company to get that kind of collaboration and
yes.
general work than in a large one?
Yes, that is much easier.
You've been in both, actually.
I've been primarily in smaller companies. I've not worked for very large companies. The largest company I worked for was Don Baxter.
If you had something to do over, what would it be?
I would have gotten an MD degree.
Really?
My mother-in-law said, when she discovered that I had a doctorate, not an MD, she said, "I'll be willing to put you through medical school." And I said, "No, I want to do research." And I have found that I have been hampered in my research by not having an MD degree. That I could have done a lot of things where I needed cooperation with an MD that I could run myself. Mm-hmm.
Would you have foregone the PhD to get an MD?
No, I would have gotten both.
Both. And if you, and that's it? No other missteps?
No, I think I've done very well.
Yeah.
I've never been without a job.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And you have a very strong and supportive family as well.
Yes.
And, you've been able to maintain that in spite of all of these career changing projects. Any suggestion there?
I don't know. I love my children. I spend as much time as I can with them, and they all get along very well. I have no problems with them, and they're all supportive.
So a matter of priorities. Keep that straight. Well, thank you very much. You've been a great friend and a great collaborator for years, and I appreciate your giving us your thoughts, looking backwards and forwards.
Thank you.
Thank you.